the need to follow good examples, began to think that we all have examples that we have followed. In fact, that's a major part in the learning process. Whatever you've learned, there's been an example there that you have followed, an example that you have learned from. In fact, I think most of the things that I've learned through life, I've learned through the example of others. Growing up, I learned how to relate to the world and others by watching my parents or watching my siblings in particular, especially at a real young age. I learned to walk and talk. Many of us are involved with sports, and when you're involved with sports, there's a lot of things that you have to learn. If it's baseball, how to catch with the glove, how to throw the ball, how to hit. And some of us have examples. We like to watch sports, and we have examples that we look at and we follow. And those examples, you know, we sometimes try to mimic. I remember growing up in the 60s, Carl Yastrzemski was a star left fielder. He won the Triple Crown one year, and he's a great player. And so he, when he got up to bat at the plate, he always had a very unique stance at the plate, and he had a very smooth swing. So when I played softball, I tried to mimic how he stood at the plate and how he, I didn't have the same success, but you know what I'm talking about. We learn by example, and so we see an example before us, and then we try to pattern our life or our sports or whatever it may be after that. Family and friends have a huge role in our life because there are examples and patterns that they set before us that we follow. And these examples can be good or they can be bad. They can be examples that lead us in the right way or examples that lead us in the wrong way. Examples that lead us to righteousness or examples that lead us down into sinfulness. And we've all known young people who've grown up in Christian homes, but then were led astray by following a bad example. Someone who led them down a path away from Christ, not a path toward Christ. And so having a right example is really important. The kinds of examples that we look at and we follow are really important for us, and we need to choose them carefully. Now, the criteria for choosing the right example, as Paul lays it out here, is where do you want to end up? When all is said and done, where do you want to arrive? Which way is that example leading you? Paul said here, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. In these verses 12 through 14 that we've looked at previously, he is showing that his whole life is pressing toward this goal. And so as he closes out this chapter, he is exhorting the Philippians here. He says, I want you to be careful in choosing the right example and avoid the wrong example. And he speaks, first of all, about examples to follow. And the first example he speaks of is my example. My example. That is Paul himself. Brethren, verse 17, join in following my example. I want you to join me in following my example. He presents himself as a good example to follow. Now, this isn't pride. Paul isn't patting himself on the back and saying, you know, I'm the only example, or, you know, I do everything right. Now, we'll speak about that in a moment. But Paul does know that he has a mature faith, and he's been speaking about maturity. He said all of us that are mature need to have the same mindset that we're in a race and we're reaching for the goal. And that everything in the race is moving toward that goal. He said, now, that's where I'm living, and that's where I'm headed. And so I'm telling you that I have a mature faith that looks to Christ and that aims toward the right goal, the right end. And so I want you to follow the example of mature faith that I have set before you. Kind of like a parent with a child. All of us who are parents, as we raise our children, we know we're not perfect. We know we don't do everything right. We know we failed our children in some areas. We all have. We all have. We haven't arrived. We're not perfect. But you also know that you have a level of maturity that the child does not have. And that level of maturity is what the child needs to learn. And one way they learn it is by your example. Sometimes more by your example than by your words. When the Bible speaks of training up a child in the way that he should go, that training is not just what you tell the child, it's what you show the child, is what you demonstrate before them. You are training your children in some way. They are following your example more than your words. An example is very important. And Paul is saying, I am setting an example to you of mature faith, and I want you to follow it. Now, some may say, well, shouldn't we just follow Jesus? Well, indeed, we should follow Jesus. There's no question about that. And Paul's not saying, follow me instead of Jesus. He's saying, follow me as I follow Jesus. The Bible says in Hebrews 12:2, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. And in that context, he's speaking about being in the race, laying aside every weight and the sin that so easily besets us, and looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. So he is definitely the example, the supreme, perfect example that we are to look to and that we are to follow. Every Christian is a follower of Christ. Paul has already set Jesus forth as the perfect example of humility in chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. So why does Paul say, follow me, or why would he say, follow anyone else, if we're just simply to follow Jesus? Well, listen carefully, because I think this is an important point. Paul wants them to follow his mature faith in Christ. So following Paul is following Christ. Following Paul's example is following an example of someone who is following Christ. And while Christ is perfect, every one of us follow him imperfectly. Isn't that right? We follow Christ imperfectly. So having an example of another imperfect follower of Christ who is more mature than us helps us to see how it is done by an imperfect human. Jesus was perfect. We can't do it totally the way he did it. Paul was imperfect. He hadn't arrived yet. He said that. Not as though, in verse 12, not as though I already attained or I'm already perfected. He knew that. He hadn't arrived yet. So he is an imperfect follower of Christ who has reached a level of maturity in his faith in following Christ. And he says, now I want you to follow my example, even though I'm imperfect. I don't do everything right, but I'm in it with you. I'm struggling like you are. I have flesh that fights against me like you do. I have temptations the same way you do, and sometimes I've yielded to those temptations, unlike Jesus, who never yielded to temptation. And so I want you to look at my example and realize it's a real flesh and blood example of following Christ. And we need that, don't we? And we can look at Christ and say, oh yeah, he's perfect and I want to follow him, but man, I blow it so many times. And we get discouraged and say, oh, you know, I just not getting it. And how encouraging it is to look at somebody else who's blown it a few times and realize they're still following Christ and they're still maturing in Christ and they've learned some things that I haven't learned yet. And I can follow along with them imperfectly. Not as though I've already arrived. The other thing you need to realize, and I think Paul realized this as he's setting this forth and keeping it in the context, imperfect followers of Christ can disappoint you. Okay? Because they're imperfect like you are. And you can disappoint them as well. Paul isn't saying I'm doing everything right. He's not saying I've reached the plateau. I'm totally like Christ. No, he says, I've reached maturity. And in my mature faith, I want you to follow me, follow the example that I'm setting of trusting Christ. A real life example that can relate to our weaknesses, that can relate to our failures in faith, and show what Christian maturity looks like in real life. So what was Paul's example? He's presented, before the Philippians, he's presented an example. For instance, he's presented an example of confidence in Christ, Philippians 1:6. He says, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. He says, I'm confident in Christ that as he has begun a work in you, he's going to finish it. And so whatever's going on with you, Philippians, God's doing a work in you, and he's going to bring it to completion. I'm confident of that. So Paul expresses his confidence in the Lord. We also see in chapter 1, verses 12 through 18, that his heart is rejoicing over the furtherance of the gospel, even though it means hardship for him, even though it means imprisonment for him, even though it means some are preaching against him, and saying that, oh, look how bad Paul is because he ended up in prison. And so they're preaching against him. Paul is rejoicing that the gospel is being furthered, that Christ is being preached. He says, in that I rejoice and will rejoice. We see in Paul an example of surrender to Christ in life and death. Philippians 1:21, for to me to live is Christ, to die is gain. That's surrender to the Lord. That's surrender to the Lord. That's a mature faith. He shows a concern for the faith of others. In chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, he speaks of the need for unity among the believers. And in order to bring about that unity, there needs to be humility, so that we're not self-seeking, not causing strife unnecessarily. Paul also pointed others to Christ by personal example. In chapter 3, verses 1 through 11, he spoke of what he was in the past, what his condition was in the past, and how legalistic he was in thinking that he was doing God a service, when in reality he was opposing God until he met Christ, or when Christ met him on the road to Damascus and transformed Paul from being a persecutor of Christ to being a follower of Christ. And now everything else is rubbish compared to Christ. And so by personal example, he's pointing people to Christ, pointing to Christ and away from the things that would take them from Christ. And we also see in his mature faith that he humbly evaluated his spiritual condition. He evaluated that he had not attained yet. He evaluated that he hadn't reached perfection yet. But he also evaluated that his goal and his aim in his life was to lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me. He's telling them, I haven't arrived yet. I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things that are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. He says, that's what I do. That's a display of maturity. A display of a mature faith in Christ. That's the kind of example, Paul says, that I want you to follow. I want you to see my example and I want you to follow it, because it's an example of someone who has all the fleshly weaknesses that you do, but has a mature faith in Christ. And so he knows and understands all the conditions that we face. And then he presents other examples. Again, verse 17, brethren, join in following my example and note those who walk, so walk as you have us for a pattern, All right? We're the pattern. You've seen the mature faith when we were with you. You've seen it as I've displayed it in this book of Philippians. And he says, that's the pattern. And as you see others following that same pattern, then they are examples of mature faith as well that you need to follow. Note those who so walk as you have us for a pattern. This word note means to look at or to examine carefully. Paul's already used it once in Philippians in chapter 2, verse 4, where he says, look out not only for your own interests, but also for the interests of others. Look out. Be aware. Consider. He uses it in Galatians 6, 1, considering yourself lest you also be tempted as you're dealing with someone who has fallen into some transgression. So he's saying here, look at or consider those around you who are good examples that should be followed because they display a mature faith in Christ. He, again, as with himself, he's not saying, look for those who have reached perfection because nobody has. Look for those who have reached a level of maturity in their faith. If there's someone more mature than you are in their faith and they display that, look to them as an example and follow that example. That's what he's saying here. Note the ones that walk the way we do, the ones who display the same kind of maturity. And most of us have people in our life that we do look up to, that we admire, that we want to imitate. Paul is saying, make sure that their lives display the kind of example that Paul himself displayed. Don't just listen to what they say. You need to watch what they do as well, because that displays that mature faith. It needs to be a humble faith. A humble faith. None of us have a corner on the truth. None of us. It needs to be loving in word and deed. Rejoicing in the Lord. Confident in Christ. Distrusting self. And as Paul relayed in Acts chapter 20, verses 22-24, speaking to the Ephesian elders, he says, and see, now I go bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies in every city, saying that chains and tribulations await me, but none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy in the ministry with which I have received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of grace, of the grace of God. What does Paul say? None of these things move me. I'm not going to be moved. He's not easily moved from following the Lord, following the Lord's will, or even suffering because he chose to follow the Lord and obey the Lord. Do you have people like that in your life? We all should have people like that in our life that we can follow. People that set a good example of faith in Christ. Then follow their example as a fellow runner who has the same kind of struggles, the same kind of weaknesses, and learn how to rely on Christ, because that's what we're all trying to do in the Christian faith. We're trying to learn in every circumstance, how do we rely on Christ? How do we live by faith in the midst of this? How do we trust him? How do we obey him in the midst of all that is going on in our lives? So these, like Paul, are not perfect examples, but they are good examples. And that's what he's pointing them to. We need flesh and blood examples of faith in Christ to follow. And then in verses 18 and 19, he turns a corner here and he speaks of examples to avoid. Examples to avoid. And he speaks of enemies of the cross. Verse 18, for many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you, even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. Just verse 19. It's a serious accusation that Paul makes as he calls these ones that he's telling us not to follow their example. He calls them enemies of the cross. And there's reasons why he would do this. And now, obviously, he's been speaking about the legalists because he presented himself as one of them. But in verse 2, he said, beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of the mutilation. He's speaking about those who are like him, a Pharisee, and had Pharisaic attitudes, the Judaizers who believed that you had to follow the law in order to be saved. But Paul's language here also seems to indicate that the people he's speaking about are not necessarily Christ deniers. They may even speak of faith in Christ. They may even speak about how good Christ is and that we need to follow him and obey him. But they distort what it means to follow Christ. In Galatians, Paul confronted these legalists that while they may teach faith in Christ, they add the law as necessary for salvation. And what Paul says in the book of Galatians is that is a denial of Christ. It's a denial of the gospel of Christ. In fact, it is another gospel that is not a gospel. It's not good news. In Galatians 2:21, he says, I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died in vain. If we are to achieve a level of righteousness before God by the law, then Christ didn't need to come. Christ didn't need to live a perfect life. He didn't need to die on the cross to pay for our sins and rise again because of our justification. None of that was necessary. It was in vain that God sent his Son if the law was enough. God never gave the law to produce righteousness in us. God gave the law to reveal our sin, to reveal that we were not righteous, that we could not obey God on our own. We could not keep the law ourselves. And what happens with the legalists is that they kind of twist and convert the law into something that they feel they can keep, or at least prove that they are keeping it better than others are keeping it. And Paul was that way, and Paul presented himself like that in verses 1 through 6, or in particular 3 through 6. But it seems here that the description of these enemies of the cross in verse 19, where he gives a little more detail, that they are most likely Gentile false teachers and not Jewish false teachers. He's already talked about beware of these Judaizers. Gentile thought, pagan Gentile thought, and Greek thought, looked at life through a prism of dualism. That is, they believed on the one hand that anything material was evil, anything of the spirit was good, which led to two very opposite conclusions. In the second century of the church, this developed into what we know now as Gnosticism and had a terrible influence on the church in the second century. Because of this belief, because they borrowed this from Greek thought and from the pagans, there's a belief that material things are evil. Therefore, the body is evil. The human fleshly body, because it is a material thing, is evil. But the spirit in us, that is our, not the Holy Spirit, but our spirit, a human spirit, is good. Now, believing that the body was evil either led to asceticism, to punish the body because it's evil, or it led to an indulgence, an antinomianism. So it doesn't, because the body is evil, it's going to do evil, it's always evil, so it doesn't matter what you do in the body, you can do anything you want, you can be as evil as you want, and it doesn't matter, it doesn't affect your spirit because your spirit is good. This led to all kinds of immorality and gluttony and drunkenness and so forth, as you can imagine, an indulgence of the flesh. And what Paul is saying here, I believe this is the kind of false teaching that he's addressing here. In the context, he is saying, these are examples to avoid. Do not follow people like this. In reality, they are enemies of the cross. They are not understanding what it means to be in Christ. They are not following Christ's examples. And Paul said, I weep over these people. I weep over them. I think he's weeping because of their blindness as to what it means to believe in Christ, what it means to be a follower of Christ. The kind of things they were focusing on were not things that exalt Christ and bring honor to his name. They actually bring shame to the name of Christ. And so he shows that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, just like the Judaizers. They're enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction. And so we certainly don't want to follow someone who is headed for destruction. And again, what kind of example do you follow? Well, the criteria is, where are you going to end up? Where are you going to end up? He's saying, follow me. You're going to end up as one who's following Christ and be with him. You're going to cross the finish line. You're going to be conformed to Jesus Christ. But you follow these examples, and they're going to lead you to destruction because they're enemies of the cross. He speaks of them as being controlled by their appetites, whose God is their belly. Whose God is their belly. Likely, Paul is referring to those who believed it was right to indulge the desires of their flesh, and it had no consequence on their spiritual life. Well, that's contrary to the Scripture. We know that. Contrary to all that's taught in Scripture. And so it's ignoring the clear teaching of Scripture that these fleshly desires are at enmity with God. That they are the source of our sin that Jesus came to save us from. Not for us to indulge in. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid! May it never be! That's a total misunderstanding of grace, a total misunderstanding of what it means to be in Christ. As I thought about this, I realized that this is all through the New Testament. Warnings about examples that we are not to follow, but actually to avoid, are all through the New Testament. I'm going to give them to you, and we don't have time to go through these passages. I'm just going to give you the passage and just a little summary. Jesus warned in Matthew 7:15 about wolves in sheep's clothing. That is, they pretend to be shepherds, but they're wolves who devour the flock. He warned the Pharisees in chapter 23 of Matthew, verses 1 through 36. He warned the disciples about the Pharisees, who were hypocrites, who put on a good outward show, but inwardly they're dead men and they're filled with corruption. Those who sit in Moses' seat, and he said, when they sit in Moses' seat, do what they tell you to do, because you need to respect authority, but don't do the way they do it. Don't follow their example of how they live. That was Jesus. So he's warned us about examples not to follow. Paul does here in Philippians, but elsewhere as well, in Romans chapter 16, verses 17 and 18, he warns us about divisive people. Don't follow their example. It's a wrong example to follow. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verses 6 and 7, he speaks of the disorderly. Disorderly, which he contrasts them with his own example. He said, you know, when we were with you, we were orderly in our behavior, in our lives. Don't follow someone who's disorderly. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 3 and 5. Don't follow those who teach otherwise. And he speaks of those who are obsessed with disputes and arguments over words. Don't follow that. In chapter 6 of 1 Timothy, verses 20 and 21, he says, avoid profane, idle babblings, false knowledge, science, so-called, as if this they have this advanced knowledge. Don't follow them. 2 Timothy 2, 16 through 18, he warns about the message of those who are obsessed with disputes and those who have this desire for idle babblings and so forth, that their message is like a cancer. It's like a cancer. It infects others and it grows and it destroys the body. He says, avoid that. That's not of Christ, and that's not following Christ. That's not an example to follow. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 5, he speaks of ones that we need to turn away from. And that whole passage is, in the last days, perilous times will come, for men will be lovers of their own selves. And then he goes on to describe what that looks like. And he says, those are examples that you need to avoid. You need to turn away from those people because they're setting a bad example, an example you should not be following. We need to be wise in the example that we follow. Peter also speaks of warnings about examples, bad examples, examples we need to avoid. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 2 and 3, he speaks of those who are false teachers leading away from Christ, and that because of them, and now understand, these false teachers are not necessarily outside the church. They profess to be Christian in some sense, at least part of Christendom. But he says, because of them, the way of truth is blasphemed by the lost because of how they live, and that many will follow their ways. And so he warns about that. In that same chapter, 2 Peter 2, verses 9 and 10, he speaks of those, who, again, in that position, that they despise authority. In other words, they don't show proper respect for authority. They don't recognize the place of authority in God's program, in God's plan. And so they despise authority. In verses 14 through 15, he says that they entice people who are unstable. Again, examples that we need to avoid. We need to be careful that we don't follow those kinds of examples. John also speaks of examples not to follow. 2 John verses 10 and 11, he says, don't follow those who reject sound doctrine, who are not willing to receive sound doctrine. Jude also speaks of, in verses 16 through 19, of grumblers, complainers, and flatterers. You need to avoid them. Those are examples you need to avoid and stay away from. And so there are examples all the way through the New Testament of people who may say they're a follower of Christ, but they're setting an example that leads you away from Christ. Don't follow them. That's what Paul's saying. Look for the mature ones in Christ who will have set an example like Paul set. Because these examples that we've just been through do not point people to Christ. They do not reflect his humility in taking a lower place than he deserves, laying aside his reputation, fully obeying the Father to suffer death that he did not deserve. They don't set an example like that. Paul is speaking these words to protect the church from straying from Christ. He speaks here, back in Philippians again, of the examples not to follow. They practice what is shameful, whose God is their belly, whose glory is in their shame. Whose glory is in their shame. We live in a world like this, where shameful behavior is not only tolerated, now it is glorified. And it is not only glorified in society. There are people who profess to be believers in Jesus Christ who are glorifying shameful behavior, shameful lifestyles that are ungodly, that God condemns. that lead to destruction. And yet they glorify it. Now we can understand how the unbeliever can glorify those things. They don't know Christ. They don't know the scripture. They have no desire for Christ, no desire to worship him. But that those who profess to believe in Christ could glorify what is shameful in God's sight is almost unthinkable. And yet, not only is it going on in our day, it was going on in Paul's day. There's nothing new under the sun, as Solomon said way back in Ecclesiastes. There's nothing new under the sun. All this stuff has happened before. And we know today this shameful behavior is proclaimed all over the media. Hollywood promotes shameful lifestyles as virtuous and presents those who disagree as bigots, haters, intolerant. Shameful is what Paul says. They glory in their shame. They want everybody to know about their shame. How great it is that they're living out their shame. Don't follow that example. Their end is destruction, Paul says. Their end is destruction. Whether they say they believe in Christ or not, their end is destruction. We need to pattern our life after good examples. He also says that they are earthly-minded. Earthly-minded, who set their minds on earthly things. This is interesting, especially in the context. The focus of these bad examples is on this life, this present body, not on the finish line. Paul was suffering as he's writing this. He was suffering, he was in prison. At the very least, he was suffering because his freedoms were taken from him. Couldn't go where he wanted to go, couldn't see who he wanted to see. People could come visit him, surely. He was being slandered by people who should support him. He was suffering when he was writing this. But his focus was not the suffering. His focus was the finish line. His focus was, all right, if this hardship in the race, this hardship in the race, but I'm not done the race yet. I haven't finished yet. I've got a pain in my side. I've got to push through it. Paul spoke of a thorn in the flesh. Push through it by the grace of God. Keep going. But those who set a bad example set their minds on earthly things. They're all about this world, this life now. The shameful behavior is all about this life now. It's not about eternity. It's not about being conformed to Jesus Christ, but that's the finish line, being conformed, fully, perfectly conformed to Jesus Christ. Amen. That's the finish line for the Christian. James speaks of two kinds of wisdom in James chapter 3. Didn't have these verses written out, so if you want to turn to them, James chapter 3, verses 14 through 16 to begin with. Listen to how he describes earthly wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. That is not God's wisdom. That's not wisdom that we get from God. That's an earthly, worldly kind of wisdom. In contrast to that, we hear about God's wisdom from James, verse 17. But the wisdom that is from above, in other words, it's not our own wisdom, it's wisdom that we receive from God. It's one of the good gifts that we receive from God. This wisdom that we receive from him is first pure, so it doesn't glory in our shame, peaceable, humble, that is, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. It's people like that who are relying on godly wisdom that are the good example that we need to follow. And we need to guard ourselves against those who are setting an opposite example, relying on earthly wisdom. And we need to do that because we're told in Scripture that we need to do that. There are examples to follow, there are examples to avoid. Even among those who profess to believe in Christ, there are examples to follow and examples to avoid. And there's a reason for it. Listen to what Peter says. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 10 through 13. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Therefore, because of that reality that's going to happen in the future, therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God, the finish line, all right? That's what he's talking about, the finish line, hastening, looking for that, and moving toward that. For the day of God, because of which the heavens will be dissolved. Because of the day of God, the heavens will be dissolved, being on fire, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. That's why we need to have the right kind of examples to follow, because of what's coming, because of where we want to end, because of the finish line. That's why we need to have the right kind of examples to follow. We don't want to be led off astray and end up in destruction. And so John, knowing all this as well, says to us in 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 and 17 through 17, "Do not love the world or the things that are in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lusts of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever." What's John doing? He's saying, get your eyes beyond this world and get your eyes on the finish line. On the finish line. Where are you going to end up? That's what you need to aim at. And that's where all your energies need to move toward. And then James says in James chapter 4, verses 1 through 4, "Where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires for pleasure that war in your members?" They're not to be indulged. They're not to be considered something I just have to give into. Body's evil, doesn't really matter what I do in my body. As long as I have, you know, my spirit's good, and as long as I believe in Christ, doesn't matter what I do. Well, it does matter what I do. This all comes from things at war in your members. It's not for you. These desires are not for you. They're not working for you. They're working against you. You lust and do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight in war, yet you do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss that you may spend it on your pleasures. Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Wasn't that what he said about these people? They're enemies of the cross? An enemy of the cross is an enemy of God. And so he's warning us about those who are earthly minded. That's part of the example that they are setting. They are not to be followed because they're not following Christ in that. So why does Paul give this instruction and this warning? One primary reason, because Paul preaches Christ. He preaches Christ, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is now set down at the right hand of God. Preaching Christ, that's why. Christ did not come indulging himself. He did not do and practice what is shameful. His focus was not on the things of this world. And in fact, now, as we preach Christ, what we are preaching is that Christ is promising a better place. He is promising that we will become new creations as we believe and trust in him. And that one day we will be in a new body, dwelling forever in a new heaven and a new earth, where in fact all things will become new. That's what we're aiming for. It's not about what's going on in this world and what's happening here. It is about eternity. It's about conformity to Christ in perfection when the resurrection takes place. And then everything about our Christian life now, directing ourselves toward that. And we're all doing that imperfectly. Sometimes we're doing really well, and other times we are easily turn away or led one way or the other, and we have to get back on track. We always have to get reminded again. That's our end. That's the finish line. And that's the goal of our life, to reach that finish line. You see, Christ came to deliver us from the old life and bring us into new life, a new life that is provided by him through his death and resurrection. And when Jesus gives us new life, everything else about the old life is now worthless. We see it for what it really is. And our focus is now on this new life and all that Christ has provided in this new life. When we enter this new life, Paul likens it to a long-distance race with a finish line being the resurrection, when we will be completely conformed to Jesus Christ. And when we're there, completely conformed to Jesus Christ, everything will be new. And that newness that Christ has placed within all of us who are saved, that newness will reach its climax, it'll reach its completion when we are resurrected in the presence of Christ. And that is guaranteed for everyone who is born again. We will arrive. And he's saying everything in life now is to aim at that, because that is the goal, that's the end, that's the finish of the race that you're in. Don't get distracted away from that. In this race, we must be careful what kind of examples we follow. We need to follow someone who's sticking with the race, who knows what the goal is, and keep moving in that direction. Paul here shows us how imperfect humans, by the grace of God, can live for Christ in this life. We need to follow his example, and we need to find others who have a mature faith and follow their example as well. We need to heed the warning of Proverbs 14:12. There's a way that seems right to a man, but the end is a way of death. Where are you going to end? Where are you going to end? Do you want to end well? Follow Christ and follow those who are following Christ. Follow those who are setting an example of following Christ that fits with the scripture. Christ has provided new life as he saved us from the old life. He gives us eternal hope beyond this life, a hope that will go on forever instead of eternal destruction. And so we hear the words of Jesus from Matthew 7, verses 13 and 14. Enter by the narrow gate. For wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who are going in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. Which way are you headed? what's going to be the end? Is it going to be Christ and all you have in him? Or are some of the other things become more important to you and lead you astray? Whose example are you following? I know you're following Christ. You're seeking to follow Christ. But human examples, what human examples have you seen in your life of a mature faith that you're seeking to follow? Paul says we need to do that. And we need to follow for the glory of God as imperfect humans seeking to live for Christ and to honor him with our lives. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for the Apostle Paul. He truly is an example of godliness. He truly is one who set aside all the earthly desires and the things that would have distracted him, and he kept his focus on Christ and on the finish line. And Lord, we know there are others in our lives that have made more progress than we have in their Christian walk and their maturity. Help us to find ones like that we can follow in our Christian walk so that we can learn how to live out our faith in a fuller and more complete way. Father, how we need you. Because there are so many things that lead us astray, that direct us away from Christ instead of toward Christ. And we pray that you would forgive us for our sins. Forgive us for our lack of faith. Forgive us, Lord, for our pride that so often gets in the way instead of humbly following Christ, humbly following others who are humbly following Christ. So, Lord, we pray for any here without Christ. Help them to consider their end. Help them to consider that there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. That is a serious, serious warning. Rescue people from death today and bring them into your life, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I ask Joe to lead in our closing hymn, Your Name.
All right, please stand with us and join us in singing Your Name.